Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, all glory to your name. Hallelujah. Well, folks, it's good to be back here with you. Hallelujah. You can be seated, and we just been having a bunch of fun in Zambia. Hallelujah. By the third day, all the Baptists that were there, most all the Baptists, one holdout, by the third day, one holdout, came, stood in front of us, lifted their hands up, said, I'm ready. And by about the fifth day, we had different ones, older men of God, who said, look, I want to repent. I backed away from the gifts of the Spirit and the moving of the Holy Ghost in my life. And I want a fresh touch from heaven. And of course, the way I was supposed to have ministered three night services and a bunch of day services, and ended up I ministered a bunch of day services and eight night services. And by the time we got to the seventh night, they were, talking about going 8 weeks. And I figured that you guys really wouldn't be that supportive of 8 weeks. And we felt somewhat of a release to go, because that place was blown up. It was just blowing up with the presence and power of God. I got a message from Phil Smithhurst this morning. He said, listen, man, he said, everybody's just glowing, Thanks so much for all that it cost you to come. Of course, Ann and I, we hadn't slept for 30 hours. I mean, closed our eyes. We hadn't slept for 30 hours. By the time we got home, which was around 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon yesterday, and give me a choice of doing anything in the world, and it still can't hold any candle to being able to lay down our life for Jesus. There's nothing like flowing in the power of His presence and the wonderful realms of His glory. And our passion is to bring people to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to bring people to a full saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, what it really means to walk around in His abundant life. It's so many people have accepted the earthly ministry of Jesus, and praise God for it, His death on the cross and His resurrection from the dead, but they've never accepted His heavenly ministry. And I mean, His heavenly ministry is, hey, His earthly ministry is amazing, the means by which our sins could be washed away instantaneously by the power of His blood and by the power of His name. There is no other name given under heaven whereby men could have their sins washed away instantaneously at the cost of nothing but acceptance. I mean, it just doesn't exist. Go search out all the religions of the world. And then, if it were just a religion, I mean, that would be kind of comforting, if it's just a religion and you didn't really feel anything and nothing really happened, it would be somewhat comforting. But then, all of a sudden, you come into a miraculous manifestation of the presence of the Lord. It was a little baby, young girl, she's 4 years old, 5 years old, right around that age. And she type 1 diabetes so bad that they had to have a little pack on her, to where they, monitors continually and all of the things goes on with that. And they took the pack off of her, and her pancreas started producing insulin, which is just miraculous. I mean, we had so many wonderful miracles. Everybody got healed. Everybody got saved. And I think there was, at the end, when I left, I believe there was one holdout, one Baptist holdout. And it was there, and I mean, I'm certain she was doing her very best to maintain her position, and it was really crumbling around her, because I think someone came to the meeting and said that the Southern Baptist Convention had announced that the expression of tongues through the baptism of the Holy Ghost is a real expression of the power of God. And it's like, and during the meeting, and so it was pretty cool. I said, "Man, talk about being late to the party." It's just like, it's like the closing hours. Well, come on in, man. We're still going. I'm glad you finally showed up and you're recognizing that this is the glory of God. Hallelujah. And you know, I know there's been a lot of wrong expressions, because there's been a lot of expressions of the Holy Ghost that haven't advanced and led into something what Father had purposed for it to lead to. People just get stuck. And you know, it's wonderful when you get a lot of folks who really haven't been exposed to the holy things of the Holy Ghost, and then they haven't got an ability to resist. Even if they're Baptist or Presbyterian or Episcopalian or just nobody, Hindus, Buddhists, Muslims, Jews, because there is a presence of the living God in their lives that communicates something that is irresistible, something that everybody knows that there's something happening. I don't believe in this, but there, you know, it's like I've had a person say to me, I've had more than one, I don't believe in this, but there's something crazy happening to me right now. I've never felt like this. My whole body's trembling. Why? And I have no idea why my whole body is trembling, and I feel extremely good. It feels very, very good in here. We recently had someone say that in one of the meetings that we were doing, and said, you know, I just don't believe in this, but this feels amazingly good in here, you know. And you know, my response to that is, wow, you know, this is just the hello in God. Imagine what it's like when you start living with Him. Imagine what it's like when you start allowing Him to fill you up with all spiritual blessings. I mean, can you imagine spiritual blessings? What does that look like? That's life forevermore. I mean, every good thing that you have, every good thing that you know about in life comes out of the realms of something that is truly spiritual. It's not something that is natural. And unfortunately, many people experience spiritual things that are just, you know, just the basic goodness of God blessing all men everywhere, because He causes His sun to fall, shine upon the just and the unjust, and causes His rain to fall upon both the good and the evil. Now what's happened is Christ Jesus has made a way so that you and I could come in to the holies of holies and behold Him. You know, while I was ministering one night in Zambia, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and just said something very, very radical to me. And I mean, he really set me on a course of something that I've ministered for years and haven't really emphasized as much as I need to, because I really just spend quite a bit of time trying to bring people along, because I've watched so many people just get stuck, and it's just so unfortunate to get stuck. You know, listen, here's what the Lord has purposed to do with your life. If you're willing to stop your stuff and let His begin, He's willing to bring into our lives not only an overwhelming glory of His presence, where we're living every day in joy unspeakable and full of glory, not pretend, not, you know, religious kind of, you know, high-five Christian joy unspeakable and full of glory, but not really while we're screaming and hollering and feeling disgruntled or whatever, but real genuine joy unspeakable and full of glory and peace that passes understanding and all these wonderful realms of heaven. No, God's divine purpose is to cause that you feel that sense that are overwhelmed by that continually, and then the expression of it is being made manifest when you sing. When you open up your mouth, there is a power of God. There is a place, if you get hungry and thirsty for it, there is a place for His manifest presence to be in your life, that even when you're just talking about breakfast cereal, people start falling out under the anointing. Huh? Because this isn't just a funny, honestly. I know it's kind of funny, but it's not just something to laugh at. It's true. I mean, one night I started praying, oh God, I mean, everybody was just laid out, Baptist, Presbyterians, Pentecostals alike. And I'm just like, you know, Lord, we pray that even the animals start falling out on the property. You know, or of course, we're in Zambia, in the middle of Africa, and so, you know, Livingstone, Zambia, so that's something that, there's a lot of animals. That, you know, the Lord just emphasized, He spoke to me something, whispered something to me in a radical way. And it became a part of one of the themes. I mean, when I went, the Spirit of the Lord just told me, just talk about my heavenly ministry, you know. Because most people have been, especially if you're on the mission field, you're out there, man, you're on the front lines. You it's not like you're, you know, just warming a pew, deciding whether or not you're going to serve God. You just like surrendered and you've gone. And you're out there in the big middle of it. And so the Spirit of the Lord just said, talk about the Holy Ghost. Just talk about, the Holy Spirit just said, talk about me and watch what I will do. And so that's what we did. And the Spirit of the Lord whispered to me and said, Paul had a radical encounter on the road to Damascus. He had a revelation of Jesus. And that set the course of every, you know, set the change of everything in his life, set the course and direction of his life. But he had even a more radical encounter than that. And I'm like, when the Spirit of the Lord spoke this to me, I mean, it just exploded on the inside of me. So you're gonna be hearing about this for the next 15 years. That's kind of what God does. He like gives us and then it's like, whoosh, you know. And it was, you know, the Lord spoke to me out of Galatians 1:16, where Paul had a revelation that God had purposed to reveal Jesus in him, his son, his only begotten son in him, his son, the sonship ministry. And so, you know, I just talked to you a little bit about that this morning and some more tonight, and then on Wednesday night, and then every other night that I'm going to be ministering. And, you know, I'm just going to, by the help and the grace of the Lord, I'm just going to quit dealing with your problems and your issues. And just, you know, and just let you decide whether or not you want to hold on to your problems and issues. Because I've spent my life, I mean, you know, I can still get an anointing to give people a headlock, get people in a headlock. I mean, I had the other night. It's like I had an anointing. There was a couple of people came in the meeting, some of those older missionaries come in the meeting, and I got a Holy Ghost anointing, a headlock anointing to wrestle people to the ground and say, listen, you know, quit fighting God. But, you know, the reality of it is so much of the time we're just begging people, we're pleading with people to just, we get locked in. I get locked in. I found myself locked in to wrestling with people saying, why do you want to go on with your life like it is? I try to hold the mirror up in front of them and can't say, can't you see? Try to tell them, Jesus, can't you see something not right here? And because God has made it so simple for us to have everything that he has, as long as we're willing to get right. All we got to do is say, God, I'm sorry for being me. You know, I'm sorry for living my own life. I want to be done with this. And then he does for us what human ability could never do. It's his grace. He gives us something that we could never earn and we never would ever deserve. You know, God in his love and kindness has brought his glory to us, and he delivered us. He delivered us. Paul said he delivered us. He used, I know King James and many translations use the word just saved us. But saved and delivered is the same word, and I like to try to replace words that people have just, you know, they familiarize themselves with, and they made it common, ordinary, and it's never become a living reality. He delivered us by the washing of the water of regeneration. I mean, it's like a whole new genetics, regeneration. It goes beyond any other kinds of concepts. It goes beyond the concept of reincarnation. It goes beyond the concept of incarnation. It goes, it's regeneration is being made completely new. I mean, God, praise God, God was incarnated. In other words, he took upon the robes of flesh. He became a holy embryo. The eternal God became a holy embryo to give his life for you and me so that we might have his life so rich and free. I mean, to have the life of God, to live the life of God, and people are making choices continually, making wrong choices. See, God the Father is cultivating a fruit. There's a fruit that he demands. He's cultivating a fruit. And so Paul said, you know, we are laborers together with the Lord. And he said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9. He said, we laborers together with the Lord. We his husbandry. We his building. Well, Paul understood what he was doing, but I wonder how many people today really understand what it is that they are doing, if they're co-laborers together with his ministry. Because Father, James said it like this in James chapter 5. He said, Father is waiting for a precious fruit of the earth to come forth. He's cultivating. He's trying to cultivate something. And that which he's cultivating is this wonderful and glorious privilege to walk out this brand new life as a son of God, as a child of the living God, where Christ Jesus is manifested in us. Paul, in lofty words, speaks to the glorious church. That's my title for Ephesians. He speaks to the glorious church. And in Colossians, he just goes and takes it right on. He just picks it right up and says it again, almost on the same level, the same subject, saying the same things. But he says, as you have received Christ Jesus, so walk in him. To come to grips with this wonderful, unspeakable gift where Father has given us the privilege to have his very own life. If there's anything that God's people need to understand, is that they have the privilege to receive the very life of God. This is the message of Jesus to a woman who's been married 5 times and living in adultery. I'll give you the life. It'll be the life of God springing up on the inside of you. This is the message to all, everybody who came that day to celebrate the great Feast of Tabernacles there in Jerusalem. Come and I'll give you a drink. If you just ask me, I'll give you a drink. So many people are stuck in a thinking realm. They're stuck in a religious realm. It's either religion. Let me help you guys out. It's either religion or it's the Holy Ghost. That's just it. Because everybody's trying to dice it all up and say, you know what, now you're, people are religious about not being religious. I mean, it's all confusing when you sit and listen to people try to sort it out and try to give you all of their analysis. Man, God has so fully simplified everything down for us and the manifestation of his only begotten Son. And we've got this privilege now to fully live for him. All we've got to do is be willing to participate with his program. Paul said, we've been washed with the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. This is the definition of salvation. Not just some dimension of the Spirit of the living God living and dwelling among us. Not just some dimension of the gift of righteousness and a dimension of the gift of holiness as you might be able to behold in the Old Testament. But an unlimited, glorious outpouring of the power of the living God upon our life. And all we've got to do is want these things and want to live in these things and begin to accept and embrace this unspeakable gift of the salvation of God where we literally have the life of God having stepped into the inside of us, having received a gift, having this life to where we possess Christ Jesus and he possesses us. Where the Lord Jesus described it in John chapter 15 like this. He said, I'm the vine, you're the branch. And because of this, there is a fruit that's going to be produced. A fruit that God is precious fruit. And we spend many years talking about how this gospel of the kingdom must be preached to all the nations as a witness unto them, and then the end shall come. But I'm going to tell you, James cries out in James chapter 5, verse 7, and he says something about waiting and being patient unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, because the husbandman, who we know who the husbandman is, it's the Father. He's cultivating something. He's continuing to work with it until it's produced. It's a precious fruit. And we know what the precious fruit is. Jesus said, you can do nothing without me. That the very life of God, Christ Jesus, being made manifested in our life, because we surrender ourselves over to the heavenly realm. I'll go back to Jesus for a minute. Jesus makes it very, very clear, for example, in Mark chapter 4, when he's talking about the fruit that is being cultivated, and he talks about the seed of the word being planted. And we've received an incorruptible seed wherein we've been born again, where that regeneration, where that renewing and that change of life took place, where we became in every dimension, holy and acceptable to God, an incorruptible seed by the word of God. We were born from above. We were born again. And there, here, Father comes, and with all the grace, and with all the power, and with all of his goodness, and with every heavenly blessing, and with every wonderful aspect of the working of the Holy Spirit to bring to pass this glorious life in us, and we get just distracted. I've watched some dear, sincere, honest people just so stuck in their head and their religion, and I want to be heard, and I want to be seen, and I want to count, and I want to be recognized, and I want to be to go on a list more than could be described, not able to recognize that all that mess is keeping you from something you could never earn or never deserve, nor in any way ever have or attain by your own self. It's just keeping you because you want to be, and you have all these needs for men to give you this and as it were, you know, the things and the cares of this life to endow you with something. And what the Lord says is, he says, it's keeping you from the fruit. It's choking you. I like how Mark said it. You can look with me. You can help me with the verse. I believe it's Mark 4:23. And he says, the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, and a lust for other things. Do you see that in Mark chapter 4? Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 4, and I'm going to let you discover it. What verse is it? Did I say it right? 19, verse 19. He says, look at this now, because we're going to all write ourselves out of this verse. We're going to self-justify, and we're going to write ourselves out of this verse, even though the fruit is waning. Because I'm telling you right now, listen, I'm going to tell you, you let this fruit be produced in your life, and the things that we're talking about all of a sudden will begin to be expressed in your life, and they will explode on a whole other level. And, you know, I've asked Father over and again, Father, how is it? You know, because I'll go to people, and I'll touch them. I'll go, I'll touch them just a little bit. And as soon as I get ready to touch them, I can see all that self-interest and self-defense and protection. And, oh, I don't want to be hurt and told that I'm wrong again. Just comes up. It's like, you know, this big wall of defense. And that, see, and here's the sad thing. The sad thing isn't that they're walling me out. The sad thing is that is an expression and manifestation that they're walling God out. Did all these defenses come up? You can see the guard goes up. The hurt comes in their eyes. Oh, no, I'm going to get whacked again. And that, all of that self-defense, all of that desire or strong desire or lust. See that little phrase, lust for other things. Huh? It's like Father has said, I'm going to get, Father looks at us and he says, I make you my heir. Okay. Listen, if it's not reproducible and it's not provable, I don't want it. Okay? You know what I'm saying? If it's not reproducible and provable, forget it. Then in the first place that we're going to have to look in our life is to place a demand upon our own life and say, wait a minute. And this, people, this isn't you and I trying to make this happen for us. This is us just being willing to be honest and true with God, honest and true with ourselves, and to simply say, do I have the fruit of his manifest presence and power in my life? And I'm not talking about signs and wonders and miracles. I'm talking about the manifest presence of Jesus. I'm talking about a glory from heaven. Hallelujah. I'm talking about, listen, there is something that when you begin to praise him, when you begin to sing praises unto him, that the atmosphere in the place changes. You know, come on now, listen, rather than when you begin to sing, people look at you. When you begin to sing or you begin to worship, you begin to pray, all of a sudden Jesus is unveiled. I believe that there's so many times people have mixed motives. They begin to sing or they begin to pray or begin to do things, and they're happy for people to look at them and that spirit of that, the spirit of that. Oh, see, Pastor, I'm participating. Really? And when you misunderstood? We didn't ask you to do this so that we could see you. We were telling you what you could do, what you're privileged to do now in response to what God has done for you, and there's a reward coming to you right out of the realms of heaven. Don't think of, we want you to so get God away in praise and prayer that you forget that anybody's here, that God the Holy Ghost, that God the Lord Jesus Christ, that becomes bigger to you than anything else that has ever happened in your life, that God the Father becomes who he is. He's living person who loves us so much. And the things I was telling someone the other day, the Lord came to me. I was out in the backwoods of Mississippi recently doing some things that I felt that needed to be done. And I was on this, like, you know, I mean, if I didn't believe in the miracle power of God, it would just have been too much, because I'm certain the thing had bed bugs and everything else. You know, it was just that bad. And I'm laying there trying to go to sleep in this condition. And the Spirit of the Lord came to me. Father's love began to be made manifest to me in a way that I've never experienced before. And it's going to take me a while to even begin to catch up with that and begin to express it. But a whole new dimension of how I can speak on His behalf, how I can begin to represent Him and talk about Him, comes out of that. And Father has these encounters for us. But they're never going to happen if we're not hungry for them, if we're not thirsty for them, if these aren't the most important things. Hey, you got to ask yourself, how much strong desire do you have for other things? Because it's, I mean, come on, people, the cares of this life. Do I need to sit here or stand here or sit down? Maybe I need to sit down because it's going to take me a long, long time to list out all of the things that belong to the cares of this life so you can say, yeah, you know what? I've been doing cares of this life. It keeps me out of the meetings. I've been doing cares of this life. I'm constantly, you know, overwhelmed by the need to do this and the need to do that. And, you know, the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, I believe that most of the Western world and America has a problem with that, because they've got to have a bigger and better house, or, you know, at any rate, whatever house they have, that takes a big part of your everyday life, doesn't it? It does. It takes a big part of your checkbook and whether or not you feel good about yourself or whether you have peace or feel comforted. There's a lot of people walking around right now very miserable because they don't have a house paid for. I mean, why would you ever let that touch your emotions and your feelings? Why would you let something like that? Who's going to get it when you die? And guess what? You don't even really get to decide. I mean, to some degree you do, but I mean, it's convoluted with inheritance, taxes, and other things. And who knows? That might just be snatched up by Uncle Sam and sold on the market for, you know, 1/10 the price or whatever. And you labored all your life for this. It was what made you feel happy, or made you feel sad, made you feel secure, or made you feel fearful. Imagine if that so entwines itself within your emotions, how it imprisons you to be liberated, to now receive all that Father has. I mean, a walk of trust with God says you're going to have to leave everything behind. Listen, Abraham defines for us what it means to walk out a relationship with God where righteousness is accounted unto us. And that was all in the context. I'm not just sitting around doing nothing, pulling some religious beads. That was being willing to leave everything to go and seek a kingdom whose builder and maker is God. And Father's brought us into that kingdom. He's brought us into that day. He's brought us to that day. He's brought you to this day. Father made us heirs with Him. Not later, now. There's nobody that was never said about man from the time Adam disobeyed. God made us heirs with Himself, Romans 8:17. God made us heirs with Himself, Galatians 4:7. And co-inheritors with Jesus Christ. Co-inheritors, not just later, now, right now. And He sits in a realm of authority far above all principalities, power, might, and dominion. No wonder He's given to us the authority to make disciples out of nations. But we've got to cease from doing our own thing, because reality of it is the lack of results is simply a declaration to you and to me that we're not doing it His way. All we got to do is repent. We don't have to do some great feats to prove our truthfulness now. All we have to do is fall at His feet and begin to worship Him, begin to love on Him, begin to say, Lord, I've lived my own life. I mean, I do this quite often. Lord, I've lived my own life. Oh, I don't want to live it that way anymore. Lord, I have much evidence and proofs about me that I'm not letting You rule me. And I don't want that anymore. And, you know, it's a wonderful place to live. Humbling ourselves under the mighty hand of God and letting Him exalt us. I'm having nothing to prove. What are you talking about? Proof. I mean, He's our proof. He is our evidence. And when we make Him our proof and our evidence, all that the Word of God describes is just there. It's just there. Hallelujah. this wonderful life in Christ Jesus, this wonderful place, this realm of faith. Faith is going to demand, trust is the foundation of faith. Trust is going to demand that you leave everything behind, whatever it is you're having faith for. You leave all the alternatives and options behind. I mean, I watched the other night as I just began to talk a little bit about faith. People who had no resistance to it. People, some of them laying down their life in the kingdom of God. Some of them been in Pentecost for quite some time. But the power of God just arrested in their hearts, and they're willing to go and do things of radical, just radical things to say, okay, Lord, I'm going to leave everything behind, and I'm going to put my whole trust in you. And now putting my whole trust in you. And that act of relationship, it's a relationship act. It's not an earning relationship act. It is something that is born out of relationship. And those are worlds apart from each other, people. Those are worlds apart from each other. Doing something to earn relationship with God, to earn approval from Him, versus doing something as a result out of relationship and out of having received approval. See, all my relationship, all my approval has been granted to me through one, Christ Jesus, through His death, His burial, His resurrection, His ascension and exaltation. I mean, come on, dear, come on, people. Listen, can you imagine? I want to paint a picture for you just a minute. Can you imagine that the church lives from the time that Jesus died and rose from the dead, that they live in those 50 days, 47. They live in those 47 from that time to here. There was no day of Pentecost. What were they doing? They were afraid. They were hiding out in upper room. Huh? Oh, Jesus is God. We thought he was going to do, we thought he was going to be exalted king and we were going to rule with him. Just imagine that reality of it is that is actually a snapshot of how many people live their Christian lives, because they never stepped into his heavenly ministry. They didn't hear what John said, I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me. He will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. They didn't hear the last message of Jesus in John when he spoke in Acts 1:5. Said, remember what John said, you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost, not many days from now. They never have understood that when Jesus said, come and drink, and out of your belly shall flow these rivers of expression of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. And after that, he was glorified, Acts 2:33. He poured forth that which you both see and hear. Many people have never stepped into that, and thus they're living a limited revelation of relationship with God. They living steer fearful and in doubt. No, no, what are we going to do when they're hiding out? And now you can only hide out for so long because you got to eat. And now you're going to go out there and you're finding more sense of fulfillment. And people telling you that's a good job that you're doing there. And look at how, wow, what a nice car. And oh, you must be blessed. And oh, look at this. And you got a house. And oh, you got grandchildren. And you got great grandchildren. And this is the definition of being blessed. That's what you call blessed. I admit it's a blessing, but God's got something far more for us. He's got all spiritual blessings over in the heavenly realm, all the realms of divine power and divine glory, all that pertains to life and godliness, everything that belongs to that which lasts forever. You know, I've heard people say, well, a loving God wouldn't send people to hell. Well, let me just tell you right now, He's not sending you into your problems that you have right now, which are hell. And I hear people say, oh, it's been hell on earth for me. I've been going through hell, H-E-double-L, two sticks on fire, hell. You know, kind of all their expressions of hell. Well, the Lord didn't do that. Your choices did that. Your choices did that. You're going to have to choose God's choices if you want these blessings. You're going to have to begin to be willing to say, Lord, shine a floodlight of heaven upon my soul. Because, man, I've wrestled with people to the ground. I've tried to cross-examine. I've tried to show them. I've tried to say, shh, don't do that. And then they're just offended. They don't even know what I'm saying shh about. I'm saying shh because the sound of your voice is sending the wrong kinds of chills up and down my spine. Because it has nothing to do with the quality or the beauty of your voice. It has nothing to do with whatsoever. It has to do whether or not it's all, listen to me sing. See, when you get used to the anointing, you get used to the presence of the Lord, and the Holy Ghost is doing it through folks. Hey, it's beautiful. You just get ruined. Then you hear somebody singing, and it's like, can you hear me sing? Isn't it beautiful? And it's like, gross. It's like it's another realm. Same way with praying. Same way with prophesying. Same way with witnessing to other people about Jesus. Like, that's terrible. Let me just shut you down right now. You just don't listen to what he's saying or she's saying. God's something far better for you. He wants to talk to you out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. But you're first going to have an encounter with him. And I believe, you know, as I'm looking across this group of people here today, that most everybody in here, you've had some measure of an encounter with Jesus. I prayed for a missionary the other night, and he's like, you know, I'm done with myself. I'm done with living it my own way and doing it my own way. And here he is laying his life down on a mission field. I want it to be God from this day forward. And power of God hit him in a radical way. And then one of the leaders of the ministry there said, you know, this guy does this like three times a year. Three times a year he gets real with God, and then he goes back to whatever it is. You know, the stuff that disappoints him, the stuff that captivates him, the prison that he's created for himself. And you think, well, Mike, we'll just give up on that person. No. The Lord constantly calls you to come. Every time you decide to go back, it really does fortify you against potentially coming, but we're still going to believe for the miracle. See, reality of it is those kinds of folks, they need somebody standing over them going, don't move like that. No, you can't go that way. They really do need someone to come, you know, and begin to speak into their life, saying, you can't think that way, you can't act that way, you can't have those kinds of behaviors in the life. And the beautiful thing is someone has come. The Holy Ghost. He has come. He's come to talk to you. And right here is the warm-up spot. Here's where you tune in your radio dial to hear God the Holy Ghost speak. Here's where you get adjusted into a frequency to hear from heaven. But what if you can't hear what we're saying? You know, that's why John said, he that hears us hears God. Because we're speaking out of that realm. And if you don't hear us, you don't hear God. Because we're speaking right out of that realm of the Spirit. We're speaking to you. We're not talking to you about things that you can do for us or things that you could be for us. We're declaring to you this unspeakable gift. We're declaring to you these realms of divine power and glory. We're here in this God's stead. We're here declaring to you a realm of heaven that if you can now begin to listen to, and if you can now begin to hear, and now you can begin to respond in a greater disposition of surrender, it's the same results that will take place in your life as God the Holy Ghost speaks to you. And now it'll go up. It'll just continue to increase. What keeps God's precious fruits from coming forth in our life now that we've been born of him? Jesus breaks it down, real clearly breaks it down. What's going to choke the word of God so that that which God the Father and his, those who are laboring with God the Father in cultivating. I'm laboring with Father to cultivate something. Every word I'm saying, everything I'm declaring, it should bring you to an altar call. God the Holy Spirit should bring you to an altar call every day of just complete and total surrender. Father, I built the altar. There's one thing that I want to see people become a part of, is become a part of a culture of the kingdom of God where they found a place to stand and minister before the Lord. Not just religious things, not just an expression of the Holy Spirit when you get to a church meeting and now everybody's looking. But I'm talking about alone, a quiet place, a separated place where every day you find where you stand before the Lord. Somebody said to me, they said, hey, Pastor, you know, I heard you say that you were running a race with Paul. He spoke in tongues more than them all, and that you were going to outdo him. He said, I'm going to outdo you. I said, bring it on, man. I said, let's do this thing. Let's get her done. Let's see your moves. Bring it, because now you just inspired me to pick up the pace. Bring it. Let's get this thing done. hey, my desires are wrapped up in a heavenly realm. Somebody said, that's just weird. Well, no. Your earthly interests are just weird. That's, you've built your little sandcastle around some temporal existence that is going to perish with the using. Your fame, your fortune, your behavior, your manner of living, the way that you view yourself. People, I want you to understand this. People who have nothing have it a lot easier opportunity to go ahead and let God be everything. Those people who have been given, as it were, everything or all that men can afford to give you, whether it's out of the realms of academics or athletics or whether it's out of the realm, anything in the Western culture of finances and whatnot, you can begin to have security and a sense of self-importance and self-worth and value within the framework of all of those other things, the desire of other things. See that verse? Could you see that? You don't need special glasses. People want to talk. I've heard most of my life people throw the word around, oh, cult. Cult is when you do something and practice something that's not written in the Bible. When you've refused to believe what God has said about His Holy Spirit, it's just as bad as refusing to believe what God has said about His Son. In many respects, I'm not going to take it fully to the full length of that, because I believe that he that hath the Son hath the Father. But I also believe this, that when you fall in love with the Son, Christ Jesus, you want every dimension of relationship that he has for you and the ministry which he wants to endow you with. And an honest and sincere heart is not going to listen to men speak too much longer. You're going to start listening to the Son who's speaking from heaven. And praise God, it's written down in His Word for everyone to evaluate. You get to walk out of here with an honest and sincere heart and say, listen, I've read the Bible and I know what He's saying is true. What He said was right from the Scriptures. Or maybe you don't know the Word of God that well, and you go, well, you know what? I'm going to go and give myself to the reading of the Word, to the reading of the Scriptures, and find out whether or not what He said is altogether true in God's way. Or the other disposition is this, I just disagree. It doesn't accommodate your life. It doesn't fit into the picture and the framework of those things that you've made yourself feel very comfortable about, those things that you've set as your goal and your purpose in life. There are many people that if they came to me and said, Pastor, what do you believe I should do? I would say, quit your job and go to the mission field. I want you to quit your job, and I don't want you to go tell anybody how famous and wonderful and great you are. I want you to quit your job and be a nobody and go to the mission field. Because it's going to come out. It ain't going to be too long, and you're going to just be in pain to tell somebody how wonderful you are and what great things you've done. And all of that is keeping you from living out the life of the Son. That self-interest, that self-identity, that self-purpose, the driven out of your own self-worth. Listen, the Lord will give you a greater self-worth than you can ever give yourself. He'll give you a greater self-importance than you can ever give yourself. I mean, the very life of Jesus Christ manifested in you and me. And He was always empowering everyone with the fullness of His life. And even from the very beginning, the 12, go and do what I did. Go cast out devils to raising the dead. The 70 others also, I empower you to live out the divine life, the heavenly life, my life. Go cast out devils, raise the dead, the whole spectrum. Then just take us to another level of the divine life. These works and greater works. There's so many people, believe me, that sit in churches all over the world, and they are unmoved by the fact that God has said, I give you the authority, anyone who believes, I give you the ability, the privilege to do these works and greater works, and they don't have even His works, and yet they still remain unmoved or unconcerned. They go back to reading their books. They go back to calling somebody that will tell them how wonderful they are. Could you please tell me again how good I am? How wonderful I am? How well I've done? Huh? And they'll manipulate. They'll do whatever they got to do. You know, there's husbands that tell wives, you don't really love me. Because they're manipulating them to try to get out of their wife to tell them how great and wonderful they are. Because they're empty inside. There's a void. That which God, the Father, is cultivating, they've never allowed it to be cultivated in them. Some have been born of the seed of the Word. Others were just born into religion. And they've got all the right Christian ease. They've got all the right terminologies. but the manifested Son, the Spirit of the Son, the Spirit of Christ Jesus. See, it's not just sons defined by Adam or by angels. It's sons defined only by the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And we look at it and we go, this is too amazing. This is too wonderful. It goes beyond anything that I can do. Exactly. It does. And now all you have to do is come trade your life for His, as He's traded out His life for ours. And He says this most radical thing when He begins to describe to us how that we live in Him and by Him and in this oneness relationship with Him. He says, without Me, you can do nothing. So I want you to think about all the things that you can do. That's what you're doing without Jesus. That's your own life. That is the deceitfulness of the cares of this life. Well, Pastor, don't you think that the Lord expects for us to provide for our families and to be, you know, to work hard and, you know, and be faithful in business? Not at the expense of living out the life of Jesus. Not at the expense of being unwilling to simply obey those things that He's told us to do. The Lord will give you more than you can gain for yourself. He said, you seek first the kingdom of God, I'll give you all these things. You seek these things, you're nothing, you're no different than the rest of the world. You seek what you should wear, you seek what you should eat, you seek for yourself houses and land. I mean, you know, when Jesus talked to the disciples and He's saying, listen, those who have forsaken houses and lands and family for My name's sake and for the kingdom, she received not only in the life to come, but in this life, 100-fold. It's just to describe it, how God will bless you. Hey, He'll give you a wonderful house. You may be so busy in the kingdom, you don't ever get to live in it. It's kind of like you visit it. Huh? It's a wow, you know. There's nobody been in our house for 2 weeks. I was telling the Lord, you know, on the way back, we were just like worn out. You know, like I said, we poor aunt, my dear wife, she wasn't feeling well when we got ready to leave. And I said, well, sweetheart, you can stay. I'm not staying. She made a divine appointment. I'm getting on that airplane. As soon as I get on that airplane, I'm going to be absolutely, from the crown of my head, so is my feet, completely whole. Because it was like a couple of times, you know, she was just having this week of just, you know, one thing after another. And sometimes, when the first time we pray, it's as though nothing happens. But you know what? One thing you can be certain of is that Father is going to always be faithful concerning those things which He's promised. And He heard. You know, just because sometimes there's a delay, it should have no impact on you, seeing as you are certain that He heard you. See, as you're in a relationship of love with Him, that it's absolutely a sealed deal already. And so, you know, it was like for the weekend, the whole week, and this one thing after another, and it's like, you know, baby, I'm standing with you in this thing, so, you know, just trying to understand what was going on with their body. She says, well, finally, she says, just don't be concerned about it. I'm going to get on the airplane, everything's going to be fine. Well, you know, sometimes that's really where it comes to, where we don't regard our own life. I'm going. This is about the kingdom of God. I'm going. I'm not going to regard my own body. I'm not going to regard my own finances. I'm not going to regard my own self. I'm not going to value the things that I hold dear. What do you hold dear? You. You. It's spelled Y-O-U. You know? From a self perspective, it's spelled M-E. Those are synonyms. And we just have a problem dealing with this. You can't unless you begin to engage with God. The Holy Ghost is the only one who can show you how much more wonderful it is to live the life of God than to live your own life. And this is the real challenge. This is where it comes down to self-preservation, holding on to ourselves. Really, the cares of this life. Fundamentally understand this. The cares of this life are going to keep you from what Jesus said was singular, the most important thing. In Matthew chapter 6, the message and sermon of Jesus, the most important thing. I watch people fight. They fight me. I can watch them fight me. I can watch them fight the Holy Ghost. I can watch it wrestling going on in their mind. I disagree with you. Over careers. Because I see within people, there are some people who can have a career because it's going to be all about God and it's not going to keep them from the things of the Spirit. Other people can't have a career because they literally absorb all of those things that career gives to them, and it rules their mind and their thinking and their value system. Well, you have to then determine what is most important to you. It's because we're not talking about earning something, we're talking about getting positioned to receive. You understand? There's a gigantic difference. There's no way you and I could ever earn what Father has freely given to us through Christ Jesus. That's why when I minister on the subject of the School of the Spirit, which we'll do this Friday night, I don't really talk too much, really a lot about how to actually function in the gifts of the Spirit. I really talk more about those things that will prevent you from functioning in gifts of the Spirit. Because functioning in gifts of the Spirit, for those that have been born of the Spirit and baptized in the Spirit, should be as natural as breathing and walking around. Hallelujah. It's as easy as talking. Hallelujah. It's easy as just saying Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. However, I recognize that there's these long list of things and behaviors and attitudes that come out of the realms of cares to this life and lust for other things, especially those two. I mean, how many of you are just all upset about the fact of where your bank account is? Deceitfulness of riches. Why should it even matter where your bank account is? Father's got it completely under control. And when I am able to make and willing to make that transition by dealing with the battles that will confront my mind, and by the way, God's given us all the power that we need to take care of battling those things that would confront our mind through imaginations. Oh no, everything is going to be terrible. Oh no, if I don't go after seeking my own provision, then who is? I will have to trust God. And that could be scary because great uncle Holy Joe trusted God and died. Well, if he really trusted God and died, he really got a great reward. But I'm going to have to back you up and say this. The way you said that was you declared God to be unfaithful. And so I say that great uncle Holy Joe wasn't as holy as you thought he was. He had an outward show of things, but the inward heart had a different witness. Thus, are you with me? Hey, listen, James, the apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, was a martyr. Look what John did. He lived through everything that they tried to kill him with. Who's better off? Come on, man. Both of them were faithful in the call of God. I'd say that James was better off because he got in glory first. You know what I'm saying? An unlimited realm of that disposition that we have when we step out of this body into that one, that heavenly. Huh? Hey, Stephen, my goodness, what bad thing did he do? He was martyred right off the bat. Why? Because of the glory of heaven revealed in his life. You know, God gave us the expedited plan, not a protracted one. You know, whereas Philip, he got to live out a long life, have four daughters that prophesied, become a centerpiece of church authority during his day. Who was better off? They were both living out what God had purposed for them. Both of them had this wonderful, great, rich reward. I would say that Stephen was better off. He didn't have to go through half what Philip went through. But at the same time, Philip was better off because he got to manifest Jesus in his mortal body while he was alive. Are you content with what God is doing in your life? Are you willing to say, wait a minute, he's come in purpose that the fullness of the measure and the maturity of his ministry should be revealed in my life? And somebody's just all excited and happy about the fact that they're prophesying? Hey, sweetheart, that's great for the first 2 months. Now let's move on now. We're on the expedited program, not the protracted one. Jesus is looking at guys who got it after 3 years. I mean, you know what? After a year and a half, they sent out raising the dead. I mean, come on. They sent out opening up blind eyes. And he said, listen, it's important for you that I go away. It's expedient for you that I go away. Because if I don't go away, the Holy Ghost can't come. And when the Holy Ghost comes, he's going to take everything that belongs to the Father and he's going to reveal it to you. He's going to manifest it to you. Because if you don't have a revelation of these things from heaven, if you haven't received them from heaven, you're just frustrated because you can't do them. Huh? It's just spotty. Who wants to live a spotty, abundant life? Raise your hand if you just like to have a spotty, abundant life. Well, I remember one time about 4 years ago, the power of God moved through me and somebody got healed. My goodness, well, praise God. I mean, you had one little token of the power of God, but how about what? How about an abundant life, living out the fullness of this wonderful realms of divine glory? I love what Paul said to the glorious church at Ephesus when he said in Ephesians chapter 3, he said, first of all, be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being, because that's where it's got to be begin. That's where it's all got to begin. That's why you're here today. You're not here to critique whether or not my sermon is good. You're not here to critique whether or not your favorite song was sung, or to bring out your spiritual thermometer and tell us how much of the power of God was manifested in the meeting. No, sir. You're here to be strengthened by the Spirit of the living God so you can do something, being rooted and grounded and settled in love. Hallelujah. People want to try to love one another, give me a break. You have to start loving Father first, because He's the source of it. And the Holy Ghost will pour into your life. The Holy Spirit will pour into your heart this love of God. And I'm telling you, show me some people that are happy, huggy people, full of love, just being willing to lay down their life, not living constantly from one emotional upset to the other just because somebody didn't smile at you properly. Or whatever else goes down in all of the realms of heavenly disinterest and human super interest. I could preach a couple of days just on that one little subject right there. Being rooted and grounded and settled in love. May comprehend with all the saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. This goes beyond anything that you could ever learn within the context of what men can teach. Why be fascinated that you're just, up to speed? Or maybe not even up to speed, maybe even that you're like on the cutting edge of what men know. Because it's foolishness to God. It'll get you nowhere. It'll change no one's life, starting with yours. It's going to make you more miserable, create more stress for you, cause more problems and disgruntledness. Oh, my mom to say it. Come on now, listen to me. When now you can know a love that passes knowledge. And understand this. Understand this. This love has a proof. It has a result. It has an end product. It is, and be filled with all the fullness of God. Knowing this love results in being filled. Ooh. So he says, oh, fill me, Lord. He's ready to. He's ready to. He's ready to give to you some things. He's waiting for you to make some decisions and to place before Him some evidence of the disposition of your heart. That the kingdom of God and His righteousness is more important to you than anything else. Doing it His way. Oh, I'm just tired of sitting around. You need to sit around. I just need to go do something. You need to sit around until you endue the power from on high. Until some dispositional changes take place in your life. Where rebellion isn't there no more. Where pointing the finger and criticism. Some people have this three witnesses. Them, me, myself, and I. There's your three witnesses. You don't want to have those three witnesses. You want to have, Jesus said, there's two witnesses here. Me and my Father bears witness with me. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you right now, in that bearing of witness, everything that Jesus did, He fulfilled all righteousness. What did He do? Everything that the Word of God described. Everything that the Word of God said, He was doing it. Thus fulfilled all righteousness. When He came to John to be baptized with John, John says, no, He tried to forbid Jesus. He said, I need to be baptized with you. Jesus says, no, let's do this. Let's get this done. Let us fulfill all righteousness. This is what Father has purposed. This is what He's planned. It's not some kind of, just arbitrary, subjective. Well, I just feel this is okay with God. Who wants to do something that they feel is okay? There's two words in there that are just dramatic to me. Feeling and the okay thing. Both of those should cause you to cringe. I feel this is okay. No, man, I want a witness from heaven. The Holy Ghost bearing witness with my spirit. That and the Word of God describes. I want what God's Word describes. Not just, not what His Word describes to me in my favorite passage of Scripture.
Hallelujah.
I pray that today that you begin to cry out within your heart, Lord, I want to be used more by You. And what does that mean? Lord, I want to live out the heavenly life. And I like to say it on the side of, Lord, I want to be used more by You, so that you don't define the heavenly life based on what suits you. But you'll define the heavenly life based on what suits Father, what He's willed. When He willed for you to be filled with all those divine realms of glory, to be raptured in the place of heavenly visitations, to be raptured in the place of such relationship that you begin to find yourself endowed as an heir. Not being as though one who differs nothing from a servant, not being like a child, but one fully entrusted, fully empowered by the living God, that would cause of you to deny yourself and take up your cross. Ooh, come on, man. If he wanted to deny themselves, take up the cross, then they'd never been endued with power from on high. They've never lived out the heavenly life. They don't understand the glory and the riches of this relationship that causes this outworking of divine grace through their life. It's like going and trying to buy a pearl. So sell all that you have to buy a pearl that you've never seen. It's just on the word of somebody. Well, I hope this is going to work out. It ain't going to work out. And that's going to be just all this self-sacrifice and, oh, you don't know what I've been through. I've heard it. Somebody's like, oh, I put so much into this. And it's like I'm not getting anything out. Uh-oh, you don't realize it, but you just revealed your heart. The problem was just made manifest through your own declarations. People, we have a purpose here. We're laboring together with the Lord. We're laborers together with the Lord. He's a farmer. He's a husbandman. He's cultivating something. It is a fruit that it is called precious. This particular Greek word is used in two concepts, really outstanding concepts in the Scripture. Precious blood and precious fruit. There's a precious fruit. God's got a reward out of this. Jesus said that unless, he says this in John, I believe it's chapter 12 and verse 24, I believe. He says, unless a grain of wheat fall into the earth and dies. He's talking about himself. You know, in this particular instance, he didn't say the Son of Man must go to Jerusalem and suffer. In this instance, he said, the Son of Man is about to be glorified. Whoa. Hallelujah. Kukaramangia shikananeya. Hey, any of you been going through some hard times? Huh? Will you quit adding to them? Hard times is to get your attention so you'll turn your heart back over and say, okay, Lord, I want it your way now. Huh? See, we stand rejoicing with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our faith, lest it's important and needed for us to be going through some misery. Huh? Some suffering. That the trying of our faith, which is much more precious to go. We have places where God sees you don't trust me. You didn't trust me. I love you. I love you. It's not a question. I love you. But the reality of it is you don't trust me. And I want to help you with that. He doesn't say, I love you. The reality of it is, you don't trust me. Adios. He doesn't say that. Praise God, he doesn't say that. I love you. The reality of it is, you don't trust me here, and here. You trust me right over here, but you don't trust me here. You trust me for later, but you don't trust me for now. You trust me in the past. You trust me in the future, but you don't trust me in the now. God's more interested in the now. He wants the now. So he says, what I'm going to do is I'm going to begin to work with you. I'm going to begin to deal with you. He says, the Son of Man is about to be glorified. He says, I'm a laborer. Really, I'm going to put what he's saying in here. I'm a laborer together with the Father. He's the husbandman, and he wants to bring forth a precious fruit. And lest I sow my life by the death of the cross, my life, the life that I have, will remain only mine. It will remain only mine. I will not be able to give it away. I will not be able to reproduce it. But if I die, if I lay down my life, it will bring forth much fruit. This is this fruit that Father is cultivating. This is the fruit, the seed of His Word is to produce His fruit. This is the fruit for which Christ Jesus died. This is all that the cross of Calvary is about. And we want to have Jesus, we want to have His life in our life too. And I'm going to tell you people, you listen to me right now, it will never work. It will never work. God ain't going to have it that way. No flesh will glory in His presence. He ain't mixing it up with you. He's not saying, wow, you're pretty cool, man. You know what? I'll tell you what. You know, I'll take some of you. Jesus. Father's cultivating a fruit. The fruit is relationship, because we see the full manifestation of it in John 15, 16. He said, you didn't choose me, I chose you. Wow. I'm chosen by God. Are you chosen by God? Yes. If you have an opportunity today to find out, if you don't know for sure. Because the beautiful thing about it is, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe. That means, another way we can translate it is, that if anyone who would believe. Huh? These signs, these works are available to anyone. The Lord's always talking about anyone. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Anyone. God's not willing that any should perish, but everyone should come. Hallelujah. And then we find ourselves in the context, having been willing to respond. He chose us. When Jesus died at Calvary's cross, He chose us. Whosoever would believe. He chose us in Him, not outside of Him. That's why John says, he who possesses, has the Son, Christ Jesus, has life. To live in Him, to find our purpose in Him, our whole identity, our whole value system. He is the Word incarnate, and this Word describes who He is and what He wills. And Father wants us to be conformed to the Word, Christ Jesus, the Son, in every way, in the dimensions of how we just simply listen and read the Word and say, yes, Lord, I want that. You know, I love to tell people, everywhere I go, I love to tell people, and you've heard me say it over and over again to you, there's only one word you need to learn. There's only one word you need to learn in your relationship with the Lord. Yes. Hallelujah. Not maybe. Let me pray about it. Lord, have you considered? He's clearly considered everything. He's already searched it out from the beginning to the end. There is nothing that surpasses, that He left out or surpasses His understanding. He knows exactly what the results will be when you move in faith, when you step out and risk everything. I tell you. Shu, if you're watching, I'm being stirred for Japan. I was asking the Lord, I'm being stirred for Japan. And you know what? You start getting stirred for something in God. You know what happens? You start getting the flashes of all the obstacles and all the hurdles and all the what ifs and what, you know. And it's always... always in that context of when you begin to analyze and think, it's always negative. It's always a flop. It ain't gonna work. It's impossible. It's beyond how to figure it out. Don't do that, because you're not gonna go anywhere. I'm being stirred for Japan. I'm being stirred for the great things that God would do in that nation. We're just saying, Lord, how do you want us to do it? Do you want us to? I was thinking today. I was, as it were, in good, holy, divine imaginations. Thinking how wonderful it would be to do an outdoor meeting on the lawn of the emperor. in front of his palace, the stronghold of Japan. Hallelujah. Somebody prophesied to me the other day, said, God has opened a door to you step in and inherit India. I'm going, hey, wow, I'm doing it. Kerala to Sikkim. Hallelujah. Kerala, right? They said it wrong. Kerala. Kerala to Sikkim. Hanina Shikina not to see it. Where, see, because when we begin to make, when we begin to conform all of our life to what Father has described, His will becomes our will. His desire will become our desires. Out of that, we get to live greater than kings. We get to live greater than the rulers of the world. Did you know that kings and families of kings and princes still rule the world today? They just do it behind the scenes. They got all the money. There's a list of family names where they've had money since the 7th, 8th century. There's nothing, there's no power more wealthy than the Vatican. They've been investing and reaping huge benefits and money and great wealth. I mean, they've got their own monetary system. They've got their own city. Come on, I mean, just think about it. There's kings and powers that rule the world from behind the scenes. We just think, oh, well, we're going to vote. Go ahead, vote. Oh, we believe in the voting system because, you know, reality of it is we can turn the thing upside down for a little while. It's like revival. It lasts 3 years. At best, revival lasts 3 years because people don't know how to go on in it. They don't have the same passion that took the ground to live in the realm. And then see, a passion that took the ground in the kingdom of God, and then the passion to live in that realm. And they just kind of, begin to say, well, this is our expression, this is what we believe, and then this is our group, and, you know, God did these wonderful things through our group, so we must be very special, and so we're going to hold on to this thing. No, that was just a stepping stone. Okay, God was just blessing you, saying, yeah, you're on the right track. Now come on into the fullness of the measure and maturity of my ministry. Go ahead. Now come on over into the realms of all the reality of the heavenly that I want to bring and make manifest through you. There's a verse of scripture in Matthew 21, verse 43. The Lord looked at Israel one day and he says to them, I'm taking the kingdom from you. See, they had the kingdom. They had the privilege of being those who would represent the kingdom of God on earth, to go and execute His will, to show forth His power, to show forth His glory, to show forth His who He is with Him dwelling in their midst. I mean, look at how God tabernacled in the midst of Israel when they were willing to walk in obedience and submission to them. And He looks and He worked with them and He tried to cultivate it and He did everything He could do to bring forth this fruit and He comes to the tree and the tree's still not bringing forth fruit and the good men of the house said, let's cut it down. Why cumber it to the ground? There's nothing. Everything I've done to cultivate fruit has resulted in nothing. It's still stubborn and interested in holding on to all of its life power for itself and not produce anything. And the servant said, give me just a little more time. Let me work with it a little more. Let me cultivate it a little bit more. Let me fertilize it some more. Let me work with it some more. Perhaps it might bring forth that fruit for which it was created and for which it was purposed. He's talking about you and me. We want him to be talking about somebody else. But it ain't going to do you any good until you recognize that this is addressed to you. You and I individually will stand before the Lord and we will give an account. And I'm going to tell you right now, comparisons, competition, you listen to me, and compromise are all demonic. They belong to a demonic realm. They have nothing to do with kingdom of God. Compromise, comparisons. People always comparing. Well, I'm not as bad. Hey, she didn't go to the meeting, so why do I have to go? Or he didn't do that, so why do I have to do it? It goes on all the time. It's a demonic analysis of your life in context to what everybody else is doing, and it has no relevance to what you and I are one day going to have to stand before the Lord and give an account for the deeds done in our body. This is a love letter right from heaven, an opportunity given to all men, everyone equally, no matter where you come from. It doesn't matter if you are Jew and you were born of the Aaronic priesthood or whether you were Scythian, the most evil and vile people that lived on the earth. And it would have been like saying a bunch of sodomites and worse. Whether you are the most righteous of the righteous or whether you're the wicked of the wickedest. He's saying to everybody, come on. Everybody's got an equal opportunity to repent, to be changed, and now to be filled up with all these things of heaven. See, the Lord wants us to come under the rod. He wants us to come under a sovereign rulership. People say, oh, he's my Lord. Well, okay, that's good. Bless you. Is he your ruler? I like to take words that we have just, we've normalized. And in many ways, sterilized. So it can't reproduce. And replace them with the synonym words. Is he your ruler? I do only what he dictates for me to do. And he first dictates in his word. Eh? And those who are ministers of his word. That's his system. Somebody said, well, I just don't believe you can trust a man like that. You know. Well, you know what? Father's bigger than any man. And when you do these things that you do is under the Lord, not under the man, I'm going to tell you right now, Papa's going to step in. Nobody can prevent God's will for your life except for you. Can you hear me? Should I be turned up? You know what? I have purposed in my life that the Abiding Place Ministry, which I believe is one of the best churches on the planet, if not the best, amen, that everybody in here are going to look just like one of the 12. At worst, one of the 70. Huh? I mean, at the very least, one of the 120. Somebody said to me, he said, well, you know, what is it that you're going for? Great man of God, love him very much. He's done great things and in the kingdom. Well, what are you going for? I said, I'm going for a church that looks like the 120. He said, don't do that. I said, well, why not? He said, because you're not going to get it. Just make it broader. Just leave it. Just do the best you can and make it broader. And I said, okay, well, you know, I know you're a wonderful man of God and everything. I'm just kind of saying to myself, I'll try to work on this mentally. God, I'm going to leave it, right? And you know how you can deal with these things? When you know how you can deal with these things? Here's how I deal with these things. I just start reading the Word. I submit myself. I don't act arrogant. I don't act like, oh, you don't know what you're talking about. He's done a lot of great things, and God maybe he does know. Maybe all I'm going to do is just leave it. I mean, you know, it's like one dear brother said, hey, listen, don't try to do the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, these works and greater works. You'll collapse under the pressure. And I'm like, and I'm telling you, I'm like, okay, you know, I'm not going to act all arrogant and act like I know everything. I'm just, okay, well, collapse under the pressure. You know, I'm not going to say that I was better than this man or that man or the other man who actually did is seemingly collapse under the pressure. But, you know, there's another way to do it. I'm just another way to do it, I'm sure. Because it's not a pressure. It's privilege. Huh? It's privilege. Because do I look like I'm under pressure? Oh, God, I got to have 5 miracles, 3 raisings from the dead, 2 blind eyes, 1 deaf ear. Otherwise, I'm not feeling like that my ministry is doing what it's supposed to do. Everybody's supposed to be shaking in the sheets right now under the power of God as I minister. No. Those are the things that the Lord is going to do. I'm not under pressure to do them. We're just going to have fun. We're going to speak his word, and we're going to watch God confirm his word. Christ Jesus will confirm his word with the miracles. I'm not under pressure for the miracles. That's his department. My department is to be the announcer. Jesus is here. Get ready. It's going to be good kind of thing, you know. But at any rate, people say these different kinds of things. All I do is just start reading the Bible. I'll say, okay, Lord, I submit myself to you. Okay, Father, I heard what Jesus, wonderful men of God, servants of yours have said. Now, Lord, I just want to hear from you. And I just start reading the Word. And then I get up from the Word, and I'm under the, I still love everybody. Don't have any bad feeling about anybody saying something. You know, I don't feel intimidated because I'm not living under fear. I'm not under fear. Fear creates intimidation. I'm living in this wonderful realm of the spirit of sonship whereby I cry, Abba, Father. What a wonderful realm to live in. He's scared of nothing at any time. What a wonderful Savior. What a blessed privilege to find ourselves not living under the authority of kings. I was sitting with a king the other day, one of the premier kings of Zambia, who was visiting Phil. Because all the kings have come to fill. God has brought all the whole of the nation of Zambia, the kings to him, like some right around, I think it's right around 200 kings. It's amazing. Sitting with one of the premier kings of the nation. For me, that's nothing. I honor the guy, fine. I'm in the King of Kings, man. It's not an arrogant attitude. It's an empowering one. It's different. It's an empowering one. I'm now free to be servant. I can be servant. I don't have to be served. If you're intimidated, you got to be served. You got to have somebody constantly reminding you. Tell me again, who am I? Tell me again, what's my name? Tell me again, how did I do? Tell me again, did everybody like what I said? Trying to, constantly prove something. Oh, we're here to deliver you from that mess today. A lust for other things. A need for other things. The pride of life is one of the worst of all. I can deal with people who are so, people have given themselves over to the lust of the flesh to the point that you can hardly recognize them as men, honestly. And I could give some descriptions of that, right? And you can kind of visualize what I'm saying, can't you? They've so corrupted themselves morally. Far, far worse. It's far more corrupt. And we're going to have to let the Holy Spirit show us, because he's the one who's come to lead us and guide us in all truth. And he wants to deal with us and he wants to discipline us. But if we're not willing to be disciplined, if we're rebellious, if we're stubborn, that's why it's a sin of witchcraft. Why is it a sin of witchcraft? Because it opposes God. It opposes the Spirit of the Lord. Father wants us to find the wonderful realm of lowliness and meekness. You want to understand how to receive all that Father has and fully represent him? Jesus said, come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. Humility, brokenness before God. It is something that by and large is almost absent and foreign to the church. The other day, the Spirit of the Lord began to work within me. Such a radical word from heaven. I'm like, oh, Lord, help me to know that you want me to even begin to speak these things, because I've right now got my hand over my mouth on them. And it is the Lord's radical declaration of those denominations and those churches who fight against the Holy Ghost by fighting against his manifest power, his gifts of his Spirit. They fight against the person. And some of the things that the Lord was saying were people have made choices to say, there was denominations, whole denominations, that made choices in 1906 to say that what was going on in Azusa Street was not of God. And the issue is, how does Father feel about that? And then the other question is, how much do you allow those who have taken such a position to influence you? Oh, well, we need to tone it down because we want to reach out to these people. We want to reach out to those people. No, I'm not toning nothing down, man. I'm not going to take a position, oh, God, tone it down. Here, I'm actually responding to those kinds of pressures, and I'm going to be willing took under those influences to tone it down, then I'm actually saying to God by deed, tone it down. I'm like saying, I'm like, just the opposite. Father God, pour it out, increase it, louder, stronger, more powerful. You'll have to just understand. I've been preaching about 3 times a day. And so it's a little bit hard for me to try to figure out how to do quick Sunday morning service. I've been preaching 3 times a day to Westerners, Americans in Zambia who don't want to move out of their seats. And I was so blessed, man. They had me start, it was like 9 o'clock the first morning. I started at 9 o'clock. And they're supposed to be taking breaks. And I forgot about the breaks. And nobody reminded me about the breaks, right? And so it's like, hey, are we supposed to take a break? And everybody's like, and then I said it again. Are we supposed to take a break or stop for lunch? And then somebody came out of the back room going, yeah, we need to break for lunch. And everybody's just sitting there. And I'm going, thank you, Jesus. I came to Zambia to find people from America hungry for you. Ha! I mean, like, everybody who's hungry for God goes to the mission field. Except for in this church. And I'll tell you right now, you can't keep coming back unless you're hungry, because how can you put up with this kind of stuff? How can you put up with this kind of a message? And because it would just haunt you. It's like, I'm not going back there to hear him talk about how I'm not doing what's right. I went to church, somebody said, I went to church to feel good. And after I've been in the meeting, I feel worse than I've ever felt in my life. I've had that report many times. And I'm so glad that I'm secure in him. I came to feel good, and you made me feel terrible. Why do we make you feel terrible? Yeah, why? Because we're just calling you to come over here, respond to God, not live an earthly life anymore. I'm just asking you. I know this may seem like a hardship, but I'm asking you from this day forward to not live an earthly life anymore. To live. Now, if we're asking you to live a hellacious life, that would be terrible. We're asking you rather to live a heavenly life. It's a heavenly life will cause you to rather to lay down your life than be the king of the world. Just living in heavenly life, there is no sacrifice too great. Huh. Hallelujah. In this realm, I'm exceeding glad in all my tribulation. Hallelujah. Jesus. Shake the nations of the world.
Amen.
Shake this nation most of all.
Jesus.
My mind, okay. All Father needs to do that is to find within you and me yielded vessels to where his glory can freely bust out of us. The reality of where you stand with God is expressed in the midst of his church. Expressed in the midst of his church. Here's where reality and truth shines brighter than any place in any other context in your life. Right here in his glorious church, which is the fullness of him that filleth all things. It's where it resides. In his church, he's placed all of these gifts. In his church, he's placed his apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. In his church, he's placed all the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit, the place where men can be perfected, where they can be built up, and they can come into the work of the ministry. Here in the midst of the church, the response, the interface, more of a dynamic of a radical interface takes place between God and his people in the midst of the context of the church than any other context that exists in our lives. And it's the most difficult one for us to deal with because we have to face the reality of where we stand before him. I pray in Jesus' name that every one of you will bow before him, that you will say to him, O God, I've built your altar here. The wood is laid in order according to your word. Your sacrifice is ready. Send your fire now. Because, dear people, this is our call to present our bodies, a living sacrifice, our bodies, his members. Join unto him. For the fullness of his life to be expressed through us. Here's our call, the call of God in our lives. It's time that God's people to be no longer children tossed to and fro by the cares of this life, by the deceitfulness of riches, by the lust for other things, by the tricks of men and of devils. To no longer just live as it were babes wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Jesus was there just so long. It's time for God's people to go ahead and respond, desire the sincere, the true, rich word of God so that they can grow. It's time God's people be willing, let the Holy Spirit will and purposes to so impact your life that these things of God become that which you've purpose to do. You're guided by him. You're led by him. You're empowered by him. Not just once a week, every single day. Not just every single day. Moment by moment. And so here we are today, consecrating our lives to do this, letting God do whatever it needs to do within the context of the way we respond to him. If there's sin going on in your life, you stop it now in Jesus' name. Today, if there's been sin going on in life, be cleansed by the blood. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Somebody said, it's just too hard, Pastor. It's just too hard. It just, no, no, I guarantee you, I don't care what sin you're going through, we'll send you some places in the Congo. And you won't be thinking about it no more. You have bigger issues to deal with. Huh? It's the love of ease. There's no sin that has come up against man to tempt men, except for that which is common to men. And with everyone, God has made a way of escape. Just many people have not really determined that they're going to serve God. Determined that they're not giving their bodies over to the lust of the flesh anymore, to serve fleshly interest. Thank you, Jesus. I want you to come back tonight, because tonight I just feel like the Lord would have me just take up from where I'm leaving off and just begin to deal with you about why we've been strengthened by His Spirit to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Where are you going to go with that? How you can begin to take a stand in God that will cause you every day to be strengthened to a place where you find all these works and ministry of Jesus being made manifest in your life. Everybody stand with me. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Father has a glorious realm of life for you to live. Father, His purpose that you live the life of His only begotten Son, that you live this life of heaven, that you live this life which was in Christ Jesus when He was the eternal Word, before He laid aside the riches, all of His riches, He laid them aside. Think about this. And He became poor for our sake, that we through His poverty might be made rich. God has given to us a life that was described within the context of who Jesus was manifested to be when He walked this earth for a little more than 33 years, with emphasis on those three last years. Listen, listen. But it's the life that He's had through the ages, from eternity past into eternity future, that He's purposed for you and I to grab hold of, to have, to say is more valuable than anything else. I tell you this, you are more important to God, you as a person, than anything that you do. Does Father need people? Is He looking for those that He might use and show forth His glory through? Absolutely, because how shall they hear unless there be a preacher? But how shall there be a preacher unless he be sent? Thus Jesus said, you must first be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And oh, look at the glory of the church as they stood as one man before God. Every man submitted to His divine order. Oh, look at the authority. Look at how the earth began to burn with the fire of His presence. As men were joined together under one body, under one banner, we spoke to the Lord and worshiped Him with one mind, with one mouth, with one heart. Oh, let revival shake the earth again, that the church may be fully formed in Him, that they may be conformed, every one to the image, function each one as members in His body. If you've not turned your life over to Jesus Christ so that His life may begin to be made manifest in yours, and it starts off with love and joy and peace. It starts off, Jesus said, I've come that you might have life, the real life, the God kind of life, and that you might have it abundantly, more abundantly. And God, who is able to do super abundantly beyond all that we can think or ask, will put on the inside of you a power that brings it to pass. It's a wellspring. It's a river. It's a glory. It's His own life in you and me, Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus. Let me just say this to you, dear people. You listen to me. There is nothing that can stop this church of Jesus Christ, this ministry of Jesus Christ, which I'm telling you for certain, I know this, this church, this place called the Abiding Place Ministry is right at the center of it. It is right there in a position before God to go all the way with Father, to be a part of that which He would do to bring change in this nation and the nations of the earth. I want you to be aware of who you are in the context of what Christ Jesus has made you and the opportunity that you have in this place to go on with God, to go on with Him in a way that He demands, a way that He demands. Come into a place where we learn to live and move and have our being in Him, where we, as we have received Christ Jesus, so we walk in Him, so we live out His life, for He purposed. Paul said, when I discovered, I saw Him on the road to Damascus, but when I discovered that He purposed to reveal His Son in me, I conferred not with flesh and blood. When it came, a revelation came to me that not only was He my Lord, my Savior, my Messiah, the one who brought me the righteousness of God, but that He purposed to reveal the person of Jesus Christ, His Son in me. I went out into a place for 3 years and sought Him. My. Come on, Paul. Come on, be radical, man. God is a radical God. These things I was preaching, ministry just before I left. He's a radical God that has said radical things, and it's time for us to believe radically. God's a radical God that said radical things, and it's time for us to believe radically. The last day I was in Zambia, in the middle of the night, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. I didn't know I was going to preach the eighth night. I wasn't only supposed to preach. It was two other great ministers with great churches that were there. I thought it was it was all being split up. That was the thing. I've now preached every night, and everybody's saying he's preaching. Seventh night. I thought I was done. I thought for sure, man, somebody else, But I just left it before the Lord anyways. But that night, early in the morning, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me about 3:00 in the morning. And He gave me the title of the sermon. What will you believe? It hit me, man. Because it wasn't like, I got a sermon title to preach to everybody else. It's like, Papa talking to me, what will you believe? When all the circumstances and all the situations of life says something different. When all the prayers and all the songs and all the issues are confronted and it says something different. What will you believe when it says something different than what I've declared? Because I've spoken and it's forever settled. Just before I left, the Lord was just dealing with me. This phrase in every one of God's creative events, Vayomer Elohim. And at the end of God said, and at the end of every event, He said, Vayihi Chen, which literally means, and it was so. And God said, and it was so. In all of His creative events. What will you believe? What will you believe about what you can and cannot do? What will you believe about the power that has been given? What will you believe about what Father has decreed? What will you believe about what He's purposed for you to do? What will you believe concerning all the realms of His riches bestowed and made available to us? What will you believe? This church, the Abiding Place of Ministry, was lit by God. It's a candle lit by God. Its destiny and its purpose is revival. A reviving of His church. Its destiny and its purpose is men and women raised up out of this place. Not just for any other purpose, but for His purpose. To be people of signs and wonders and miracles. Where anyone can look at you and go, that person is baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Anyone. Jesus said something so radical, and I'm going to grab a hold of it, and I'm going to live it, and I want to speak it to you. So long as I'm in this tabernacle, I'll stir you up by putting you in remembrance of these things. Without me, you can do nothing. And that's all I want to do. is those things that I cannot do without Him. The fruit the Father's cultivating, the precious fruit of the earth that Father has, the husbandman has long patience for, until he received the early and the latter rain. You know what he said to Hosea? Now shall we see, Hosea 6:3, now shall we see those who follow on to know the Lord. For I shall come to you as the early and the latter rain. Urasataya, every moving of God. See, if I'm here and I'm cultivating what God is cultivating, and if I'm decreeing what God has decreed, and if I've placed myself in a position to say it radically like God said it, when He comes to us, He's coming. And He comes to us, the parousias of the Lord. He comes to us as the early and the latter rain, which is always His miraculous, sovereign movings in the earth. You know what? We will then there be found in Him, able and prepared to move with Him. That all that the latter rain, the early and the latter rain produces, what does the early and the latter rain produce? The precious fruit. People who want to shortcut God, lower the bar, try to make it less than what it is. People who want to live by doubt and unbelief instead of live by faith. People who want to live marginally, some faith and some unbelief. Some faith in this area, but other areas I'm depending upon the arm of flesh. When He comes, you won't be prepared to move with Him. The precious fruit will not be able to be seen. I'm telling you, dear people, today, I want you to repent. I want you to get right with God. The things where you trusted in the arm of flesh and you live in your own life and you're doing it your own way, and the complaint and the murmur, there is nothing that reproaches God more than complaining and murmuring. Being upset with the situation. He loves us, but nothing makes Him more angry. Nothing. Read about it. Hebrews chapter 3, chapter 4. The murmuring and the complaining has got to stop. In our streets, those streets where heaven dwells, where the heavenly glory dominates, there is no complaining in the streets. Isn't that what the Word of God says? Huh? Well, then why don't you go ahead and be identified as the people of God? Why don't you step into the realms of divine glory to where everybody, you don't need somebody to tell you. Huh? But everybody witnesses. Those people are baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. That's what Christ Jesus purposed when He bore our sins in His own body on the tree, that we now being cut off from sin. I'm telling you right now, many people have problems with sin because they're not filled with Him. They've been born again, but they won't continually be filled with Him. Because you start living this heavenly life, I'm going to tell you right now. Hallelujah. You start getting filled up with Him, you won't have a murmur. You won't have a complaint. Having a murmur and complaint just being you and God's shut out. God being filled with the Spirit is the remedy for every one of your problems. Today, in believing God, you might not go and look at your bank account on Monday morning and it be any more money in there than what was there the last time you looked on Friday or Saturday. But what will happen is you won't need any money to be there. Now you'll live by another realm. Now you'll call it in. Hallelujah. Kandazerebake. Kandala bakara sayataha. Ha ha. Hallelujah. He reached our noshe. Halamon de sayate. Thank you, Jesus. Today, this morning, this day, we're petitioning everybody in this place to fully surrender your life over to the kingdom of God. I petition you by the mercies of Christ Jesus to fully surrender your life over to the kingdom of God, to become those that belong to the living God, Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Listen, we're so blessed and we're so honored to be entrusted with the things of heaven. The Father's told us and instructed us in His ways of life what we're supposed to do. And if we simply step out and obey Him, no matter what the situation is, no matter what the circumstances, we just step out and we obey Him. then the smallest acts of obedience create the greatest miracles of faith. Somebody said, how does faith work? By love. How does love work? God pours that love into our lives. What are the results? We obey Him. The Lord says He gives us all that we need. We're simply willing to obey Him and step out. Smallest acts of obedience create the greatest miracles of faith. You know, I was looking at Phil's life, and superimposing almost every one of you upon him. He was just a guy, long-haired guy, who had to fight in the Angola Bush War, who was just an everyday, ordinary kind of guy, who gave his life over to the Lord. Now he has bases in 17 nations of the world and has a total of 50 nations on his radar, targeted, saying, Father, how do we reach them? And everywhere he goes, if there's any kind of person who knows how to flow in the gifts of the Spirit, they're saying, God's given you another nation. See, that's what happens. That's what happens when you become marked by the presence of the living God. Everywhere you go, the power of God is there being made manifested. There's a witness. We covet this for every one of you. Hallelujah. Now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get prepared now to worship the Lord with your tithes and your offerings. Remember, that's an act of obedience. Out of it, God's going to create a miracle of faith. I don't care what's going on, what all people have said, what the abuses are. It matters not. These are the things that God has said, and if we obey Him, we're going to get His results. If we do not weary in well-doing, we shall also reap if we do not faint. So I want you to just come and worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings and with your giving. And I also want anyone in this place that wants prayer for anything, if it's spiritual or if it's physical, if it's material, I don't care what it is. If you're not certain of where you stand with God, if you seem unable to step outside the realms of human ability and you want to start functioning in divine ability, God's here to meet with you. If you're sick in your body, you're diseased in your body, God's here to meet with you and heal you. If you want a touch from heaven, you just feel like it's somehow you're just not there flowing in that which God has prepared for you. You're just not flowing. See, I kind of like to do this together because it's all about the offering. It's about the offering of your life. It's about your willingness to just give over yourself to the Lord and begin to receive His riches. See, we call you to come, and just by the act of coming, you're giving yourself over, and the Lord meets you with His riches. He works a miracle that changed heart, changed life. He works the miracles of grace to cause you to grow, mature, and receive all those things which He supplies so freely. Hallelujah. 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 Ha, ha. Ha, hallelujah. Ha, ha, hallelujah. Ha, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we fall upon our knees. You see, Lord, you see our hearts bent, our hearts and our lives bent to Your will. Bowed before Your throne. Bowed. We bow. We bow before Your throne. We cry out to You, O God. Your will alone, Father. Hear what Father says. Father says, this is My beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye Him. This is what Father says to the whole earth, to the whole world. If there's anything that needs to be sounded out into the earth, it's this. This is what God says. This is My beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye Him. Hear Him. Hear Him. Hear Him today. Harden not your hearts. God, who in times past spoke unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by His Son, whom He's appointed heir of all things by whom also you made the worlds. Just lift your hands towards heaven and begin to receive your miracle. Be strengthened right now in Jesus' name. Be strengthened right now in Jesus' name. Be strengthened right now in Jesus' name. Be strengthened right now. Just receive. There's an abundant supply from heaven. It's yours. There's an abundance. There's an abundance from heaven. It's yours. Receive right now. There's an abundance. There's an abundance. There's an abundance from heaven. There's an abundance. Ha. A divine power of God. A divine supply from heaven. Ha. Just receive right now. Manjaya. There's an abundance for you. Supply from heaven. Ha. Of the riches of God. Zariah. All yours. Ha. All yours. Mamaya. All yours. Manaya. All yours. All yours. All yours. All yours. All yours. All yours. There's an abundant supply. The riches of heaven receive right now. Oh, Prabhasate. This and I. Sutanaya. There's an abundance from heaven. There's a rich supply. Mosena. Ha ha. Eshikan and Aero. Jesus. 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 Mamananea. Lana Mangalesha Paranai. The riches of heaven. Out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost. As the Lord has said, out of your belly flows these riches of the Holy Ghost. Satayare Monjaki Shipaila. The glory that changes a nation. The glory that changes a nation. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for your precious blood that cleanses us from all sin. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you died at Calvary's cross that we might live in you. That all the things that made us unacceptable would be removed from off our life and we would be born again. So now in Jesus' mighty name, the power of God comes into your life in the name of Jesus. Everything of the past is broken. And behold, everything is made new. Simply by the calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus. It is a beautiful thing that God has made a way that all we have to do is say, Lord Jesus. By calling on his name, heaven's moved on our behalf. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Holy Ghost, the very Spirit of the living God. Heaven's glory. Heaven's glory now. Heaven's glory. Heaven's glory! Heaven's glory now! Mandasaya. Mamanasaya. Mananaya brust. Mananangli. Dear people, these are simple decisions that we make. Father's already done the work. He's done everything he's going to do. These are simple decisions that we make. Heaven's anane. Ha.
Be filled. Be filled. Right out of your belly flows Laudate, rivers of the Holy Ghost. Right out of your belly flows. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Heaven's glory fills your soul. Just let God the Father have full control. You need not beg nor ask, for He has already supplied all that you have need of. Just receive. And that which you have need of is all His fullness, so He's not left or withheld any good thing. He's not left anything out. Just lift your hands towards heaven. I'm telling you now, a couple of you folks and Baptists were receiving more. We want you to get hungry. We want you to get hungry for God. God decided. God went through a lot so that we could have everything. Now it's time for us to decide and lay hold of that which He's given. Don't be willing to be without. Don't be willing to be without. Don't be willing to be without. I've watched many times as people are willing to come to the altar and be without. Don't be willing to be without, because if you're willing to be without, I assure you, you will remain without. It's those who are not willing to be without those things which God supplied, they're hungry, you see. When you have everything that God has supplied, there's no need for you to be hungry anymore. But up until that time, you should demand of your soul that which God demands. I command you to receive right now in Jesus' name. I command you to receive that which God supplies right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Bones your list. Bones your list. Bones your list. Father has so much for you. You don't have to live as you've been living. God has so much for you. You don't have to continue on as you've been. God has so much for you. God has so much for you. Don't let the cares of this life, lust for other things, choke His word. Father, thank You for the anointing. Jesus. Jesus. I said, like a mighty wind. Like a mighty wind. God said, like a mighty wind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Irishaya, Irishaporane. All heaven's glory is here for you to have. All heaven's glory is here for you to have. It's yours. Just receive. Just begin to thank Him. Begin to worship Him. Begin to express to Him those desires of your soul. Let me say this to you. I've watched the people come to the altar and they let doubt and unbelief impact their mind, their thinking. They let a consciousness of sin imprison them. And that's exactly the strategy of Satan. When all the time God the Holy Ghost would inspire you to believe, to only believe, to look and receive that which He has freely given. Why would we allow thoughts of unbelief to fill our hearts and mind when we come to present ourselves before the Lord, knowing that without faith it's impossible to please Him? Why would we let thoughts of doubt and criticism stalemate us from receiving all the Father has supplied when we've come
to present ourselves before Him. Why would you let things other than that which the Spirit of the Lord ministers dominate your soul? But you come here now, stand here to receive all that He has. Why live in a prison when Christ Jesus came to set you free? Look, God, right now, He'll begin to identify for you how you've been living by yourself and for yourself. And all you have to do then is just begin to surrender and say, I see now. I understand now. My life has been about me, mostly. I've been in charge of my soul and my spirit, mostly. Now I'm going to humble myself before the living God, and I'm going to let Him rule me completely. The choice is ours. God's already done everything He's going to do. The atmosphere in this place is saturated with all His fullness. That's what He said. His church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things. You can receive as much as you're willing to believe God for. You can receive as much as you're willing to yield your members to Him. Hallelujah. I've watched again and again where people think they need a devil cast out. No, it ain't a devil. It's you, and we can't cast you out of you. Hallelujah. You just surrender you. Hallelujah.